Here we are. We ask for your spirit to move freely, that we may hear your voice, that we may see your light, that we may be renewed, that we may be made children of light. Amen. If I were to ask you to tell me what is the first thing that you think about when you hear the word Christmas, what would your response be? What images does Christmas evoke for you? Perhaps in 1946, when Nat King Cole recorded the Christmas song, he had no idea that 67 years later, this popular tune continues to provide the images that so many have come to accept as meaning Christmas. All those chestnuts roasting on that open fire, those yuletide carols, how about that turkey and some mistletoe, toys and goodies on Santa's sleigh. Tells us that Christmas is candy canes and toys in every store, the lovely holly on the door, and of course, the grand tree that's then decorated in the hotel lobby or in the park, or for us New Yorkers in Rockefeller Center. We find that these images, from these and many popular Christmas songs, are full of nostalgia. Nostalgia for a simpler life, for a time of innocence, and nostalgia for childhood, for gathering round an abundant table surrounded by loved ones and yearning for that special gift that's going to make Christmas just right. These images are also full of a sense of hopefulness, that life will be kind, that we will be happy, that we will be loved, and that things will turn out right. And so filled with these feelings and expectations, when we turn to the Christmas story as told by the narrator of the Gospel of Matthew, we begin to realize that the Gospel account is leading us in another direction. The text is providing another context, another lens. It is giving us another perspective. It is asking us to put down the mistletoe, stop drinking the eggnog, stop wrapping the presents, and pause and open our hearts and our eyes to a new and a more profound way of understanding Christmas. As we read the text this morning, the first thing that we realize is that Matthew's account of the coming of Jesus is a very pared-down and unadorned narrative, only 8 verses long. In the Gospel of Luke, we find a much more detailed and majestic narrative. We find Joseph and a very pregnant Mary looking for shelter. We are told that there's a heavenly host of angels appearing to shepherds in the fields, and then the magical scene of worship of the infant as he lay in a simple manger surrounded by farm animals and an unknown group of shepherds. If we compare the two narratives, you would see that the story that Matthew tells is in some way anticlimactic. However, if we put aside the wonder and majesty of Luke's account, which is important, but we do a closer reading of Matthew, going to find that these 8 short verses show us that few texts of Scripture engender as much controversy as Matthew's account of the birth of Jesus. I think that while Luke's narrative may offer more details, certainly in many ways is not as emotionally charged as the story that Matthew is telling. Another key characteristic of Matthew's telling of the Christmas story is the role that Joseph plays in the story. In Matthew's account, Mary seems almost absent. It's all about Joseph, his agency, his dilemma, and his decision. In this narrative, Joseph becomes the key protagonist, the one who receives a visit from an angel and is called upon to provide a response. And given the circumstances that Matthew tells us that Joseph is facing, we are shown Joseph to be a man of great sensitivity, a man of love, and a man of faith. is that Matthew's narrative is describing a family in turmoil. Something has gone terribly wrong, and whatever happy ending that had been anticipated seems to have vanished. Listen again to what verses 18 and 19 say. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. Now this is some story. This is the stuff that makes for some very juicy gossip. Think for a moment about the upset and distress that must have consumed Joseph upon learning that Mary was pregnant. According to the first century marriage contracts, the agreement between Mary and Joseph had gone awry. The New Standard Version of the Bible describes Mary and Joseph as engaged. The New International Version of the Bible describes them as pledged to be married, while the King James says that Joseph was espoused to Mary. No matter what word you use, no matter how you render it, it's important to note that the bond between Mary and Joseph at this time was contractual, not merely social, as would be the case when we talk about engagement today. That is, betrothal, or engagement constituted the legal contract and the pledge of marriage. The wedding itself was a time when the bride and the groom were accompanied by friends and feasting to celebrate the occasion of actually joining their households. For all intents and purposes then, Mary and Joseph were married and had not yet lived with each other or consummated their union. Hence the turmoil created by discovering that Mary was Joseph was pregnant. It could, as far as Joseph was concerned, only mean one thing, that his spouse wife had been unfaithful. Now, having an unfaithful wife or girlfriend is not a good thing in any culture, but in the world that Joseph and Mary inhabited, there were very, very dire consequences for this kind of behavior. You see, the Jewish world of the first century said that women had to belong to someone. In this case, Mary belonged to Joseph. But once she becomes pregnant, she has broken her covenant with Joseph. So the question is, to whom did Mary belong? And to whom did her child belong? Once Mary accepts to carry this child, her fate as an unmarried Jewish woman is cast. Given this scenario, Joseph knows that he must take action, and he has two options: calling for the public stoning of Mary or giving her a divorce. Joseph opts for the latter course, not wishing, as Matthew describes, to expose Mary to public disgrace and presumably a very cruel punishment. We can only imagine the turmoil, the sense of betrayal, the grief, the disbelief, the shame that Joseph was feeling. And if he had shared with Mary his plan to just disappear into the night and to appear to her family and to the religious authorities that he had taken advantage of her, we can only imagine Mary's own fear and her grief. This is certainly not the Christmas story that we are accustomed to. We become accustomed to focusing on just the beauty and the wonder of the birth of Jesus, and that's fine. But here Matthew is pointing us to another direction, asking us to look behind the singing angels, the worshiping shepherds, the proud parents, and he's confronting us with the human reality and the human cost of the nativity. Matthew is telling us a story about divine action that required human response. Matthew is lifting up the importance of the human response to the divine invitation. You see, Matthew wants us to understand that if the birth of the awaited Messiah is indeed a divine intervention, then it cannot happen without human collaboration. Think about how vulnerable both Joseph and Mary were, but also think about how brave, how daring they both were as they defined their social and religious context when they were approached by God. And what makes this narrative even more wonderful for me is that it even seems that God wants Mary and Joseph to step outside the prescribed roles as a couple, the spouse to be married. God seems to be asking them to step outside the religious rituals and the social expectations. God wants them to step out of the ordinary so they can enter into the extraordinary. God is leading them to that moment of decision-making when they can become truly partners with God, when they can truly become those that would help God to bring the beginning of a new chapter. why I'm quoting the dangerously paradoxical idea that not only is God necessary to man, but man is also necessary to God, to the unfolding of God's plans in this world. And it is precisely this dangerous paradox that Matthew is presenting, that Matthew wants us to contemplate, that Matthew wants us to understand. In this narrative, we are confronted with a picture of a Joseph and a Mary that are very normal, very human, filled with the realities of human fear, of human confusion, of human pain, but at the same time, this is a story about two human beings who, despite the realities that they face, despite the negatives of their situation, despite the danger, Joseph and Mary dare to trust God. Joseph and Mary dare to believe the message of the angel. Joseph and Mary dare to go against the status quo. And it is because of their faith and their trust that God is able to move beyond the scandal. God is able to move beyond what appeared to the human eye as a violation of the law and use this ordinary young couple to bring about the wondrous birth of a child that would forever change how humans relate to God. God used Joseph and Mary. God used Joseph and Mary to give life to the one who would be a true witness of love, a true witness of grace, and who would be the bearer of humanity's salvation. In the text, Joseph is described as a righteous man for wanting to minimize any danger to Mary. And he decides it is best to break off the engagement, and God intervenes. An angel appears to him and says, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. Here we get a glimpse of what Joseph is thinking and feeling. Was he afraid of what would happen to Mary, or maybe he was also afraid of what would happen to him? Was he afraid that he would lose his lineage by having an illegitimate child? In what seems like a lose-lose situation, there comes divine intervention. Isn't that always the case? In a lose-lose situation, there comes divine intervention. God takes the scandal of Mary's pregnancy and makes it righteous. God takes the scandal that Joseph is trying to avoid and leaves Joseph to choose to act with righteousness, but not in the way that was prescribed by the law. What Joseph initially understands that the righteous thing to do is challenged directly by the call that God made for him to act precisely opposite to what the religious law demanded. And the question that we need to ask is, what happens, sisters and brothers, when our own notions of righteousness and justice come up against the ways of God's creative mercy? But there is still more to this wonderful story. By believing the angel, by accepting Mary as his wife, pregnant with a child that was not his, Joseph was literally taking this child into his household, raising him as his own, giving him bed, board, name, family identity, and a training. In his embrace of Mary, of the child of the womb, Joseph was providing a radical welcome to someone who was not his, someone who was a stranger to him. There was a gap between Joseph and his child, yet Joseph's faith and his willingness to trust God and to love Mary eliminated that gap, and in obeying the angel and giving the child the name Jesus, Joseph seals the adoption and gives earthly legitimacy to this unique child. Joseph's faith made it possible for him to set aside his own pride and step into a new role, into a new life, which would begin in a way that he had not yet dreamed of. This was truly the decision of a lifetime for Joseph. And I think we need to consider the great importance and example that Joseph gives to us. So, what about us on this Christmas Sunday, just 3 days away from Christmas Day? How does this narrative from Matthew's Gospel speak to us this morning? Have we been able, perhaps, to glimpse a new meaning to Christmas that we had not considered before? Can we see in this Gospel narrative that when human justice or righteousness fails, that God's promises never fail? That God is always present? Can we see in Joseph's response to God, in Joseph's acceptance of the angel's word, miraculous birth in the name of Emmanuel, God is with us, are scripted by God's promises. That promise begins the story and again stands at its conclusion in the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples. Remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Amen. Jesus is for Matthew the fulfillment of all of God's promises, and God's promises frame the story just as God's promises frame our lives every single day. The angel says, you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now this is serious business. We belong to God, and God will be with God's people, and in that process we will be saved from our sins and from the consequences of our sins. To be saved from sin is to be forgiven, and to be forgiven is a declaration of a new future that is no longer under the control of the past and of our previous failures. This is a profound promise. This is the Christmas promise. This child, this Jesus, born of the Virgin, this Emmanuel, is pure gift, holy surprise, a fresh act of God, a new Genesis, a new creation. Emmanuel, God with us, God with Mary, God with Joseph, God with us. God surprisingly entering human life with a creative and transforming power, a power like no other, to believe in a God that comes to us in ways both unexpected and surprising. To believe in a God that reaches out to us, that takes human form, that adopts us, that closes the gap between the human and the divine, the God that offers us salvation in a world that seems to only speak and enact brokenness and despair. We live with the awareness that God's power is among us and ready to lead us in ways that we cannot even imagine. Can you believe that Park Avenue Christian Church? This is what Christmas is about. This is the Christmas story. This is the Christmas promise. This is the Christmas gift. God with us. God within us. Holy surprise. New creation. Brand new Genesis. God with us. No matter how lonely, no matter how alone, no matter how broken, no matter how diseased, remember Daniel Berrigan from activism. But for those of you who don't know Daniel Berrigan, he's a Jesuit priest and a priest activist. And the founder of the Postures Movement, which is an anti-nuclear Christmas Christian pacifist movement. But what's important are the words of his credo, and this is what I want to share for you this Christmas Sunday. I can only tell you what I believe. I believe I cannot be saved by foreign policies. I cannot be saved by the sexual revolution. I cannot be saved by the gross national product. I cannot be saved by nuclear deterrence. I cannot be saved by alternate priests, artists, plumbers, city planners, social engineers, nor by the Vatican, nor by the World Buddhist Association, nor by Hitler, nor by Joan of Arc, nor by angels among angels, nor by powers and dominions. I can be saved only by Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. Tell us.
Today is the last Sunday of Advent. Here as Christian community, we have spent the last weeks of Advent waiting, listening, watching, as a people in darkness who yearn for a sign of the light. And the light of the world has now come. Listen to the angel call out to us. Listen, he's calling you. He knows your name. He's talking to you this morning. He said, a child is born and his name is Jesus, for he will save people from their sins. So what is Christmas? Christmas, sisters and brothers, is the ultimate salvation story. And we say, praise be to God. Pray with me. And And if this morning you need to come and to know this Jesus, the Jesus that comes to us at Emmanuel, I invite you to come forward for prayer. If you are struggling this Christmas because you are not sure what it is that God wants from you, or you are not sure that you are even anywhere near close to what God wants you to be, this is the time to come forward. For a child is born, and his name is Jesus. For he will save people. He will save you. He will save me from our sins. Dear God, hear our prayer this morning. This wonderful, surprising, miraculous Sunday of Christmas. This morning when anything is possible because you intervene. This morning when anything is possible because your power is here. This morning of Emmanuel, God with us. Hear our prayer. Look into our hearts. Look into our marriages, into our homes, into our pocketbooks, into our checking accounts, into our relationships, into our closets. Look into us and see what we need this morning and call us to a newness of life, a transformation, a renewal. This is a world of brokenness. This is a world of disease. This is a world of darkness. But you have come as a light that will not be conquered by darkness. So too our salvation cannot be conquered. Come to us. Come to us. Speak to us. Hear us. Be with us. Oh, Emmanuel. Be with us this morning, that we may find in you comfort. That we may find in you salvation. That we may be renewed.